I know. I'm like, rewind. Okay, I'm not going to say that out loud. All of this needs to get cut out, Darren, when you're editing. Like, all of this. Okay.
That's we so did good. It. Longer than 25 minutes.
I know. This is what always happens. Welcome to Talk Tennis. Today, we have a bit of a global vibe going on. Troy is here in California. Jay is here, not here, but on Zoom, all the way in Australia. Thanks for joining, guys.
No dramas. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thanks for having us, Michelle.
One of the previous episodes that we recorded with you guys did very well and was well received. So I figured this would be a great opportunity to get you both back together. And I keep saying that, like, if you guys were in the same office, you probably would be talking nonstop about everything. So today we're going to talk nonstop about tennis strings, and I'm going to probably do my best to just shut up and let you guys handle it. But we were saying that it would be really fun to talk about some of the best strings on the market for the best amount of spin generation, whether it's what you guys have found personally, what's tested the best in the lab, and all of the things. So if someone wants to start off by saying or explaining to our audience what makes a string spin friendly, that would probably be the best place to start.
Do you want me to take this on, or do you want to go for it, Troy?
It doesn't matter to me, really. But, you know, basically I can start off if you guys want.
Yeah, go on.
Yeah, so, you know, if you look at our tennis warehouse, if you get into the science of it, the university data and all that stuff, basically, you know, copolyester monofilaments tend to be the ones that will basically accentuate or help maximize spin potential of how a player hits the ball and imparts the spin on the ball. So, I mean, for example, Nadal uses a full bed of RPM blast, you know, or teams using a full bed of RPM power, two guys that, you know, probably hit some of the most top spin on the tour, even though just about most guys on tour hit crazy amounts of spin. But basically, those strings are very control oriented, low powered, which really allow that aspect allows the player to swing freely, maximize racket head speed, swing big, you know, use their technique to generate that spin. So that's a big part of it. But the science of the string, you know, more exactly, and I've kind of gotten more into it over the years, talking to Crawford, the one who runs our Tennis Warehouse University, is basically there's kind of two things that really are going on with the string and the ball interaction. And it's, you know, basically the amount of friction or the bite from the string into the felt of the ball, which is kind of obvious nowadays with like so many shaped strings, gear shaped, really rough strings. You're really trying to grab the ball, rip into the felt. But the other part of it that kind of is something that I kind of learned over the years was more of the string on string interaction. So talking about like your main strings versus your cross strings, there's a big part of the friction or the coefficient of friction between those strings. So basically in the equation of it all, you're really wanting to maximize string to ball friction, the amount of friction between the grip on the ball, you know, the way the strings grab the ball, and you want to minimize or reduce the amount of friction between the mains and crosses. So maximizing string on ball friction and minimizing string on string friction is what kind of I take from it.
Well, I was going to say, Jay,
pretty much, you've taken everything pretty much out of the book. You've hit the nail on the head. All of that is like on the Tennis Warehouse University page as well. And I think everyone can go onto that page and they can start diving into take a look. I think that's a huge database there, and you can take a look at all the different strings, compare one to another. And I can say that I like any time that I look at a different string, like I automatically go to that university, and I just look at the differences straight away. And it's very helpful and it's super accurate as well. So and like you do notice the differences. So So what are your top five, Troy?
I don't know.
We're getting in it. Like, let's go.
I don't know necessarily if I have a set top five of just what are, you know, just for spin, you know, pretty much all the polys I like give me the spin I need type of thing. But, you know, like.
Wait. I have a question before we get too far into it. Just because I just reviewed a string and I wanted to ask you guys, do you find that strings with more edges or less edges are more spin friendly, or is there a magic number of edges?
Do the edges
I'm not allowed.
That's a tough one. I don't know. I feel like it might just be more of a sensation thing for me, but yeah, strings that have that are more edgier, like specifically like four or five edges, I feel like personally I feel the string grab the ball more. Not, I don't know if it necessarily, you know, like will produce, you know, more spin, because obviously there's that string to string friction as well. But there are definitely some strings like, you know, Hyper G or Cyclone, where like you just, if you hit that ball right in the middle, you can actually feel the strings just grab it and yeah, rip the felt. So that's what I found. you, Troy?
Yeah, I'd agree with what you're saying there. I do know, you know, like we're talking about Hyper G, and then like, if you look at the Tennis Warehouse University, like the top five or so strings, pretty much all of them are that square shape. The Ultra Cable Vocal V Square, the name is square. Black Code 4S, four sides, mm-hmm. All of those square shaped strings. So there's got to be something in that shape and the way it equates out, you know, in the university that maximizes it. And yes, there's a ton of different strings with a ton of different sides. Like RPM Blast is supposedly an eight-sided string, octagonal. But when you string RPM Blast and you like really get like into the texture of it, it doesn't really feel sharp. It's very slick. So I think the magic of RPM Blast is more in the string on
the sleekness of it. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Just how easy that it glides. Yeah. You notice that when you're stringing it as well. It's just like, it's so slippery. I don't even know how it holds its tension.
It doesn't. Oh, shots fired. RPM Blast.
Very true.
Before we get into more technical things, just in case someone out there is still new to all of this information and data, will one of you guys or both of you guys take a crack at explaining the difference in gauges and spin potential?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do I want more? Do I want a thinner gauge or a thicker gauge? I know the answer to this, but I'm gonna have you explain it.
I'll try my best.
Yes, do it.
All right. So yeah, I mean, the difference in gauges is obviously the thickness of the string. So I guess the higher in gauge that you go, so sort of that 18, 19 gauge type string, the thinner the string is going to be, and then vice versa. So that 16, 15 gauge string is going to be thicker. And so the thinner it is, you're going to be able to get just a little bit more spin and a little bit more power from it. And you're going to get that because basically the strings will, I guess, be able to move a little bit more freely in the racket, and also has a little bit more spacing between the strings as well. So yeah, again, allows for that string to string movement, and then the opposite for, the lower gauge strings, they're a little bit more durable, obviously, and just maybe you get like a little bit more control and feel because there's a little bit more string in there. But yeah, there'll be a little bit less movement in that one, so a little bit less spin potential.
Okay, Now we can carry on to top five.
The only thing is, I know Chris Edwards sometimes likes to make the argument because, like at a certain point with some of the really thin gauges, like super thin, like 19, 20 or whatever, like on a tour bite or something, you know, or Cyclone, like when they get that thin, they start to become really elastic and kind of powerful. So like for him, it's a confidence thing, kind of what I talked about in the beginning, like the low powered response of the poly. He actually finds that he probably, or at least, you know, perceives that he gets maybe more spin from sometimes the thicker 16 gauge or whatever, because he's more confident, he can swing faster and get the spin, you know, from his stroke versus like some of those really thin ones. But that's just like a kind of more, you know, definitely more perceived thing, a confidence thing. What Jay just said, you know, I definitely back that 100%.
I think it's just weird, player to player kind of thing. That reminds me straight up of like the same theory, but with tension as well.
That's what I was gonna say.
Yeah. Like, because I get that as well. Like, the higher that you go, obviously, like the less power that you have. So yeah, you can just swing out a bit more, and then so I'm not shooting forehands long. So that gives me a little bit more confidence to really go for the shot, and then in turn, I'm probably spinning it a little bit more than I normally am, compared to stringing on looser. So a little bit more spin there, I think too.
And you know, maybe quite likely why someone like Dominic Thiem uses an 18-20 or Jack Sock, you know, a couple of those guys that really get a lot of topspin on their forehands, uses a 16-20, or Rafa, you know, in his 16-19 pattern uses a 15L gauge. There's a little bit of that, you know. Yeah, the pattern makes a difference.
You got to
the
balance gauge makes it a out, difference, but then, I think.
Yeah. When can I just let a full rip go?
Yeah. And of course, it has to be said, although hopefully everyone listening understands that mechanics are a big part of how much spin you're going to get when you're playing tennis. So if you're hitting the ball flat, straight, like I do, there's not a ton of RPMs happening. But, you know, someone like Chris, especially more recently, he's gone to a lighter, super maneuverable, whippy racket. He's really brushing up. Even he was saying today he's hitting even wristier than normal. So he's obviously generating more arc on the ball and therefore getting more spin. But, yeah. But I mean,
slightly underrated that one, I think, as well.
Yeah. But we all know that the right gear can change our life. So let's talk about strengths, specific strengths. I don't even know. I should have done my homework. What is the number one lab tested string for the most spin potential?
Ultra cable.
Oh.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. Ultra cable, 17 gauge, I think. Just right in the middle. Is that right, Troy?
Yeah.
I think. Yeah. Yep. And then I think it's V square as number two. And then I think RPM blast rough is also up there. They're the ones that I know that we carry down here in Australia, because we don't have as many options as you guys. Yeah,
it's the Ultra Cable, the V square. There's a Weiss Cannon, the Blue Rockin' Power, which I think is also like a super shaped string. RPM Blast Rough, and then the Technofiber 4S.
Okay. Yeah. And okay. Would you guys agree? Or you think is there something missing? What have you found? How would you compare those five to maybe your five favorite, or what you've found the most success with?
I mean, when we tested RPM Blast Rough, I was on that review. That one definitely does a really good job of gripping and snapping back. It's pretty elastic poly, so kind of like combination of the texture, the snapback, and also the pocketing. So I definitely say I felt like that was one of the most spin-friendly strings I tried. I really like Black Code 4S, or Technofiber now calls it 4S. It's kind of like a softer version of Hyper-G to me. So yeah, those are definitely right up there. I mean, my favorite polys are like Hyper-G, Confidential, which are both like a more of a square shape string, and I feel like these strings give me just as much spin, if not more. So yeah, I would probably say, like, I mean, I remember, it's hard to say without doing like a blind side by side test, you know, when you hit 100 balls and check the spin rates. But yeah, well, the ones I've tried up there definitely are some spin monsters for strings. I don't know if you agree, Jay.
Hyper-G's close to one of my favorite strings, and that's purely straight out because of how much spin you can get from it. And then Cyclone is another one that I'm just super in love with. Blast, talking about Blast, that's always a love-hate relationship for me. But I think, like, just another point I wanted to make was it, like, the racket as well makes a big difference. Like, you can play with a shaped string, you know, like in different rackets, and the racket itself will make, you know, the string can make it a little bit less spin friendly, or can make it more spin friendly, obviously. So if you put a non-shaped string in a wide open, you know, 16-18, or, you know, something that's super open, then you might feel that the string is gonna, you know, give you a lot of spin. And then vice versa, you could put a shaped string into like a really tight 18-20 you know, 95 square inch head and feel like you're not getting a lot of strength, a lot of spin. So yeah, I've been slowly like trying to, you know, play test different setups and find out like what gives a good balance of everything. And yeah, what I was saying, I guess before was like right now I'm playing with the Pure Aero with Big Banger Original. And I am like, I'm getting so much spin from that. And I don't know if that's from the racket or, but I'm like breaking a string like every week or every 2 weeks from that. Yeah. So it's, yeah, it's pretty, it's good to go through and start testing them all. But like right now, like I would say Big Bang Original is like a really good string as well for spin, but that might just be because of the Pure Aero or just my technique as well. So yeah, I don't know if you find any similarities with that either.
Yeah, Big Banger Original. I know that's Chris, one of Chris's top, definitely top three, top five strings.
Mm-hmm.
As far as its spin potential goes, it really comes down to how control-oriented that string is, kind of dead response. It's also fairly slick on the outside. And I mean, there's been tons of really, really good clay court players, professional players that have used that string over the years. So I know, I'm pretty sure Ferrer used it for years. I think that was one of the
Rafa gave it a go. Yep.
For a small amount of time. There's just a lot of pros.
Vedasco gave it a go. Yeah, I feel like a lot of people have tried it. Yeah.
It's definitely an OG legit poly.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Now, like, what about a hybrid? And what about a poly hybrid? What about, I mean, what are some pros and cons with the hybrid? Can I get more spin potential if I'm stringing with like a super grippy poly in a hybrid, even though it sounds like that probably wouldn't be the most durable string option? Talk to me about that.
Yeah, now we're getting into combinations and permutations and how many hundreds of thousands of combinations you can make.
Oh my gosh. Right. Yep. Well, and then like flashback to remember Gamma Glide.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's that too.
Yeah, that was like it was a monofilament clear string, but it wasn't like your traditional polyester. It was kind of like a softer material, very, very stretchy, very gummy.
Yeah.
So it was like a soft hybrid, or it was supposed to be like a cross for a poly to make like a more comfortable hybrid, but do the same amount of spin as a regular polyester. And, it was okay. I remember testing it out when it first came out. And it was like, yeah, there was probably a little better spin than most syn guts or multis, but like the feel was just weird. It was like super gummy. The ball would kind of just randomly spray. So maybe not bad, you know, definitely give props to Gamma for trying something different, but it just wasn't my cup of tea. Yeah. Cheers to that.
Wow. That's awesome.
There's been some shade this morning.
But as far as like hybrids go, we have tested in recent couple years, we have been trying out different poly hybrids, you know, like a really shaped square shaped poly in the mains, and then like a smooth, slick, you know, thinner gauge in the crosses. I think we even have one from Prince, the Vortex Triad hybrid. It's like a triangle shaped 16 gauge or something like that in the mains, and then like an 18 gauge smooth round across.
I think Rock and Blue Power has a hybrid also, which is a square and maybe
round.
Circular. Yeah, maybe.
And then like head had the Gravity one, which was like triangle with like a flatter, like rectangular kind of cross. Because really, I think what they're trying to get at is like that shaped string for, you know, digging into the ball. You know, your cross string is like your supporting cast for your main. So it's like you want to get that grip on the ball, but you want that cross string to allow it to slide and be super slick. So whether it's a round string in the crosses or kind of like how like square shaped polys work or like some of those really triangle ones, you almost want to get like two flat sides creating like a low coefficient of friction, getting that like really slick flat on flat surface, kind of like going between the mains and crosses. But I don't know, Jay, what do you think? Do you think like you get more spin from trying those poly hybrids or anything like that?
I've had some success by doing it. not a whole lot for me. I've tried like two different like shape strings, both like one might be four sides, another one might be eight sides. And I find that sometimes they get stuck on each other and they don't necessarily, you know, glide as well. But I have a friend here. He strings his racket at the moment with Confidential in the mains and then Ali Power Rough in the crosses. He loves that. He reckoned that that's his setup at the moment. And yeah, he gets like all the spin that he needs from the Confidential and then just that like little bit extra feel and like the rough texture from the Ali Rough to support him. That works wonders for him. So there are definitely combinations out there. I feel that will suit a lot of players. In terms of poly and poly, I haven't done that much else. I've done more like natural gut and poly combos, which I think you can definitely get, spin, like a lot of spin potential, probably like the same amount compared to poly and poly, depending which one that you go for. So like Champion's Choice, mm-hmm. great setup, great mm-hmm. setup. And I think even like having... with that one, like even having natural gut in the mains, I didn't find that I lost too much spin compared to having the Ali Power in the mains. Have you done any natty gut? Well, you would have. natty gut.
You would have.
Yeah, you would have. Yeah. What are your thoughts on natty gut poly combos or just multi-filament combos?
Like you were saying, the gut hybrids are great, amazing. I think the feel... the all-around playability is really the best you can find on the market out of any string combination. And there's a reason why, you know, Fed, Djokovic, Murray, Serena, there's just so many players on tour that are using the top players. As far as spin goes, I think there is a little bit of an adaptation period. I know we did do like a head-to-head review between RPM Blast and Champion's Choice, kind of like a little Rafa Rocker kind of thing, play on the strings. But I definitely find you can get pretty close to just about as much spin as you can with the full bed of poly. I know Crawford's done some testing on the spin potential with the natural gut mains and a poly cross and found some really high numbers, like very close to the top of the poly charts. But the thing is, for me, is just that spin combined with kind of what I would call depth control. So, like, I know Chris, me and Chris did that head-to-head review. And at the end of the playtest, he just was reaffirmed why he is a full poly player, a dead poly player, a 15-gauge kind of poly player. just because it's the combination of the spin with the predictability and the depth. So, kind of like... basically, I feel like you can get the ball spinning really, really tight and get that spin almost like you would with a poly or a shape poly. But that natural gut, you know, in the poly mixed with the poly, you really have to like figure out your tension and kind of bump it up pretty high because you do get that launch factor. So if you're talking like X-axis, Y-axis, or Y-axis, X-axis, whatever, you're getting that spin, but the ball is also shooting. It seems like the ball is shooting further on average than the poly. So you kind of have to figure out how to gauge that spin with the depth control. Whereas a poly being so dead, it's like you get that spin and you get the ball to fall really, really fast over the, you know, once it gets past the net, there's the type of thing. So I think that's kind of just the big difference for me.
Yeah. The power and that elasticity just like, I feel like that definitely makes a difference. You know, like it just shoots off a bit more. So full bed of poly. Yeah. I always recommend just if you want to be able to just have 100% full confidence to swing big and swing out, just full bed of poly, string it up a little bit higher than you would obviously, you know, with other like multi-filaments or natural guts. And then, it'll drop in.
Just like that, it will drop.
It's that easy. It's that easy.
Nice. Yeah. But your technique better be pretty well tuned. If you start using the full bed of polys and your technique's not there, then you're going to be calling us back saying, "Hey, I got pain in my elbow. Now what do I do? Oh, now try to get high." You know?
Yeah, true. Some people do say that. Oh, I've only hit it, you know, I hit into the bottom of the net, like on my first three shots. It's like, oh, okay, just aim a little bit higher maybe. But
I was going to say, it's wild to me because right now I'm kind of like, I go through these phases. I think I talked about this yesterday too with Troy, with my swing weight. And to know some of these pros who are hitting these rackets that have swing weights like well above 340 that are still generating so much movement on the ball. That's been wild to me lately. I don't know why. Like, I'm thinking like Andy Murray, like he gets the ball popping and I think his swing weight's like super high. And I'm just like, wow, with my maneuverability, with some of my RFs, I cannot do that. So I don't know. I just thought I'd throw that in there.
No, it's definitely a talent.
Yeah. It's probably why he's a Grand Slam winner.
Yeah. And he's just like a specimen of an athlete, dude. He just looks like he's like a boxer. Like, he's just like,
he is so great. Speed. Well, yeah. And I guess that's what I'm trying to say is like, anyone listening that's like, but I have this racket strung with this string and I still am not getting any, you know, RPMs on the ball. And it's like, well, what's actually happening? What are you working with? How fast are you swinging? What does your stroke look like? What's the swing weight on your racket? All of the above. What's the tension? What's this? What's that? So, yeah.
But Michelle, to make you feel better, so there's players, and I didn't know this either. I always thought like all the pros were like, oh, they got to be like 350 or higher some weight. But like, I, you know, more recently found out like that Japanese player Nishioka,
mm-hmm.
he's like a V-Core 100, and his swing weight strung is like 311 or
no.
something like that.
Oh, that's good.
I think it's close to like a 12-ounce bracket. It's not like super heavy, but it's not, you know, it's not stock, but it's like a little bit weighted up, but like the swing weight is like in the teens.
That almost takes more skill, I reckon. Like yeah. at the high level. Like how are they hitting with such a light racket against these other big boys?
And Matt, we were just talking about that. This is another episode that we're gonna have to do with you guys. And like for us, it's easier for us to talk about strings and shoes because the pros are actually using what you can buy. And a lot of times the pros are not using the rackets that you can buy. However, the episode that I went out with Haley Carter and she talked about her switch from the Pure Aero to the Extreme MP. And she basically like debunks the myth that every pro player is using a customized racket. And there's been some chatter about that. So it is definitely there. I think there's more players than not using the same rackets that anyone can buy at Tennis Only, at Tennis Warehouse, you know, so.
Yeah. And even if, and a lot of them too, I think even if they aren't using the one that we sell at the time, they're using one that was sold in retail 6 to 10 years ago.
Exactly.
You know, but it's still very similar to what a stock racket would be bought by a customer, you know.
And yeah,
throw your lip tape on there, throw your lip the grip on there, and rip your forehand like Jay, you know.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Exactly. Yeah. It's that easy.
That easy. What about this might not be as easy to answer, but what about non-polys? Well, I don't want to use a poly. What kind of multis are going to give me the most spin?
Any experience on, have you hit much multis lately, Jay?
No.
I was like, this is
not. Not a full bit of multi recently. Head rip control. Have you? Yeah, that's a good one that a lot of people down here use. Because that's just a multi, but just got that texture to it to grab onto the ball. But yeah, wouldn't exactly recommend a multi purely for the spin potential. So yeah, if a customer comes in or someone emails in, I just say maybe hybrid it for me. You?
Yeah, no, a rip control is a good one. That one, yeah, it's like a ribbon string. It's like a polyolefin or whatever the material is, but like I think even like Simone used that string for years, right, on the pro tour or something like that. But yeah, it's a softer type of string than a regular poly, still gives pretty good spin. Besides that, you know, I don't play full multi that often, but I did test some in the last couple of years just for like new product stuff. The Technofiber I think probably does the best multis on the market just overall, you know, NRG, X1
biphase.
But they do, I think some of their kind of like combination strings that they've been doing lately, like the Triax is the most recent one. That's I think Michelle, you were on the playtest. Mm-hmm. You could speak to that one, but that's a good control multi with pretty good, better than average spin. I know Chris really likes the multi feel, which is like a good budget string, mm-hmm. pretty soft, good snapback. They have the other one, the HDMX Tour, I think, which is like the green colored one. I really like that one. So I think Technofiber, when it comes to multis or softer strings, that's my go-to brand. I think that's where most people should look at. But I mean, there's other brands that have some too. I think, you know, like the Wilson NXT Control, Sensation Control, Head Velocity. There's definitely some out there that are a little bit better at spin than most multis, even though the typical multis going to be hard to generate the same amount of spin as with the Pauly. But that would be the next step, just like Jay said, into the hybrid world.
Now talk to me a little bit about the word rough on a string. And we've seen some things come through. I don't think we sell it anymore, but there used to be an apparatus where you could add the rough to the string to create more bite. And I feel like also there's a bit of like a preference. Some people like a rough string, or some people prefer like the sides, the shaped. So do you guys have a preference? Do you like one more than the other? Also, from what I've heard, a lot of feedback, a lot of the rougher strings kind of are softer than the non-rough versions. Talk to me about that.
I'll go. Yes, I think personally I prefer shaped strings over rough strings. And yeah, so rough strings will have little like indents that are sort of cut into the string. So it's the string isn't shaped, but it does have little grooves that are throughout the string itself. And that is meant to emulate the sort of similar to the shape string, where the little indents are going to grab onto the ball a little bit more and give you a little bit more spin. And so there's heaps of strings that are out there like that. Like as we're talking about, Ally Power Rough is probably the biggest seller. It's a tough one. Like I think that you do get a little bit more feel maybe out of the rough ones, because like there's a little bit less of the string in it. So yeah, you're going to get a little bit more of that, like, I guess, movement, as well. But what I was talking about before, like with the poly and poly hybrid, I feel like the rough string can sometimes get stuck on itself, so it doesn't move as much. Like the little indents and the jaggedness, like they get stuck on each other every now and again, and then so that's less string to string movement, so sometimes it doesn't give as much spin. But that might be like a mental thing for me. I'm like, hey, what's that string doing? It's stuck, that's meant to be moving. So that might be a mental thing for me. Yeah, you, Troy?
Then you got to walk to the back fins like Sharapova. Yeah. I had to bring Maria into it.
Of course. Troy, yeah, what's your opinion on rough?
What Jay was just talking about, exactly. I like the picture that Jay just painted about the string being rough. They actually like take the full string, the round string, and they take like scoops out of it to create those little dimples. Whereas like when I first started working here, I always thought the rough strings had like little bubbles that protruded out, but it's actually, they like take a divot out of the surface. So it's like more like an indent. And then the surface level becomes like the bump basically. So it's almost like a golf ball, I guess, if you think of it that way.
Okay. But
I think exactly what Jay said, some rough strings, I think there's a certain, you know, point of like being too rough, or you know, just the right amount of rough where the string plays. Obviously Alu Power Rough is like one of the most, you know, used on the Pro Tour and very popular string. I think that one has just the right amount of rough, and actually, like, if you really pay attention to the Alu Power Rough when you string it and you pull the tension really tight, it almost like kind of flattens out and becomes smooth again. So basically, like, that Alu Rough is, it's a little bit more lively, a little bit softer than the regular Alu Power. And I think it's exactly what Jay just said. There's a little bit less string, so they kind of like thin the string out when you pull tension on it, and it just plays like a softer, thinner version of Alu Power. But some strings that are like maybe a little too rough, like I noticed with the Solinko's kind of take on the Alu Power Rough is the Tour Bite Diamond Rough. It's almost like too thick of like ridges and almost a little too rough. So like after a while, you play with it for a week or so and it starts to kind of lose its tension a little bit. Then that's when it starts like sticking out of place, because I think the roughness kind of takes away from the string, makes it a little too much friction between mains and crosses. So I think there's kind of like a point of how much rough is good or bad.
Makes sense. What else? What else have we not covered about all of the spin potential in strings? Or what kind of questions do you guys get asked that, you know, you can help answer?
I always just get, yeah, like what are your the top three best-selling strings or most commonly used strings for spin? And I mean, yeah, it's, I guess they're already pretty well known, but you know, like Hyper G is obviously like most people's top three, Ally Power, even though that is not necessarily shaped, still gives a lot of spin potential. RPM is obviously in there. And like all of them are really, really good. And there are obviously differences between the strings, but most of the time you should be able to play with, you know, with most of them, you know. And like, I guess going back to what we were saying before, about like the pros, like most pros, their technique is so sound. Most of them should be able to play with almost any racket setup. Mm-hmm. So I think there are a lot of people that's like, you know, like really trying to knuckle down and trying to find like the one perfect setup for them. And when you do find a setup that works for you, obviously it's great and you're going to be able to, you know, like find a groove with it, and like your technique will I guess adjust to the setup that you've got. But there's no real like absolutely perfect setup that's just going to turn you from, you know, your average club player to better, you know. So like,
I mean, come on.
Yeah. What? Crazy.
You don't say.
But I think, yeah, but there are obviously setups that do suit people differently, so it is worth going through the stages and finding what works for you, and you know, different feels will suit different players. So yeah, just keep searching for it, keep trying different things, and yeah, just try to notice those different things too, I think.
And then kind of just going off that, I don't know if we mentioned too much about string tension. I just got a question earlier today on YouTube about, you know, like it's pretty common for people with like hybrids, like natural gut and poly, like two different types of string, mm-hmm. to string, you know, the main string, you know, a little bit tighter and the cross string a little bit looser, or vice versa, depending on, you know, the poly or the gut type of string. But someone was asking if I have a full bed of poly or 4G or whatever, you know, I've heard pro players stringing the mains like 2 or 3 pounds tighter than the crosses. Why would they do that if they're using just a full bed of poly? In that case, you know, what I've heard sometimes is, you know, it gives you a little bit more feel because the cross strings are a little looser, so it allows a little bit more pocketing of the ball. But also, I've heard that like just by the cross being slightly looser, there's kind of like a perceived possibility of getting a little more spin just because it allows the main strings to move around and slide a little bit easier. So kind of personal preference there, but that's something that led me to think of tension in general. And, you know, whether or not does a high tension of 55 pounds or 60 pounds with a full bed of poly, will that give me more spin than a tension of like 40 pounds or something like that? I don't know if Jay, you want to kind of touch on what tension does, or
you've nailed it. Yeah, that's I always thought the exact same thing. Yeah, if you string the crosses a little bit lower, hopefully, yeah, they'll move just a little bit more, and you're getting that little bit more feel from the string bed because they're moving a little bit more, a little bit more spin potential. And yeah, I feel like from what I know, most of the pros actually do that, so there is something there. Haven't done it too much. I've tried it a couple of times, for me, just the feel, like the actual feel, it changes the feel of the racket. I think, yeah, maybe I was getting a little bit more spin from the frame, but yeah, the feel of it just wasn't for me personally. So I just went back to normal.
And then about tension, do you feel like you personally, do you like a higher tension, or I don't know, say like maybe mid 50s or something? Do you feel like that could give you more spin, or do you feel like?
For me, I go higher. So yeah, so I can just swing harder and try to just like spin the ball faster. So that's like, so I go higher personally, but I know that there are people that go lower, string it looser, and then the strings will move more and then grab onto the ball a little bit more. So I think that's why like tension is such a personal preference. It's just like, do you want to be able to swing hard and go for gold, and hopefully, you know, like you've got the good technique to be able to bring it back down, or do you just want to be able to like let the racket do the work for you? And then or try to find a middle ground of between the two. And I think if you can maybe find the middle ground between the two, that's probably where the sweet spot is. You want help from the racket, but you also want to be able to, you know, get better as a player. So put your own effort into it. So pure aero, 55.5 pounds with original. That's where I'm at the moment.
Nice. Well, and that's kind of what I wanted to say too, is that I think a lot of people watch our reviews, and each playtester kind of has their own, you know, we all kind of fulfill a different type of player. Like Troy's all about feel and, you know, I don't know, precision and like craftiness. And I'm all about like, take all the feel away. And like I said, Chris is more, you know, working on his maneuverability and like getting the ball to like jump, and he just wants to get the ball back in play, kind of that like player that you play that's going to get everything back. And then, you know, Britt's looking to be like a counter puncher, but she's also got good power and can step in. Jay, you like bomb your serve, like big shots. So if anyone's listening out there, like maybe just try and kind of like key in on what each of these play testers kind of prefer, and that might work better for your game, or find the playtester that you want to play more like. And I'm not saying we're professionals, not even close, but I think
everyone wants to play like you, Michelle.
That's
where you're going. Yeah.
No one. People are like, you're insane. Why do you, as I like grab my shoulder, why are you stringing so high? But yeah, you can kind of like try to emulate the setups that the playtester that you want to play like. Which Troy actually is usually the one that gets all of the like, well, what does Troy think? But what did Troy say?
Well, it's mostly because like they know like I tinker around with the racket and stuff, you know, like the leather grips and a little bit of weight here and there. It's like
100%.
Myself, she's like, yeah, I got my RF97. I just put it over. I got 60 pounds. I'm gonna beat you, okay? So, you know.
No, and that's why it's cool too, is because like I think there are a lot of people out there like you, Troy. Well, Jay, so also he's put it on a leather grip. So you two are like two peas. You're very dialed in with your specs, your, you know, your tensions and all that. So that's helpful also.
Yeah, and then it could be, you know, just like, you know, we don't have as much going on, you know, in personal life, you know, we're just so stuck on the gear, you know, we don't have a life. You know? There's more people like that, like me, you know.
Dude, especially lately, maybe I should just get more techie. The numbers don't vibe well in my head. I don't like the science. Oh, well. What else? Anything else that we didn't cover that we should cover if we're talking about all of the spin potential when it comes to strings?
Is there any new strings really coming out that you're excited for? I know that Polytour Rev is one that that I've hit with, but I can't think of any others for me that's coming out.
What do you think of Polytour Rev?
It's pretty good. Definitely spin friendly. I mean, what I sort of alluded to before the podcast, hit it in the V-core, and don't know if it was the V-core that was muted or the Polytour Rev that was muted, but yeah, not a huge amount of feel from it. But when I was in position and I was ripping the ball, like it gave me everything that I needed out of a string. So, and like I didn't have that much confidence issues like when I was having a good day. On a not so good day, maybe I wanted just a little bit more comfort and a little bit more feel from it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's my take on it.
I think you're hitting the nail on the head with the feel thing a little bit. But Troy, have you hit it at all?
Not much. I think I hit a couple of balls against the wall with it. But it kind of just what he said about his first expression about the Polytour Rev. And I mean, it's no knock on Yonex strings, but it's just like every Yonex poly I've ever played with, it's like kind of like my same reaction is like, it's decent, you know, it's like nothing too spectacular, nothing horrible, you know, but it's like, there's other strings out there that just kind of give me a little bit more of that enhanced feel. And obviously, you know, we're big fans of Solinco strings.
Yeah.
But yeah. It feels like it falls in line with those. I would say the one unique one to me probably is the Polytour Pro, because it's kind of like a unique blend of like being like soft and crisp at the same time. So I think there's a lot of pros that use that string. But you know, some of the other ones, the Strike and the Rev and the other ones I've tried, they're okay.
Yeah. I actually just got some lab data from J-Dub on that string, and it goes head to head pretty well with ALU Power, in the lab at least. But I know when they were talking to us about it, there was another string that they kind of were attacking. Not attacking, that sounds horrible. Yeah. They were going after, they were trying to create a competitor in the market. Anyways, I'm not going to say the name of the other string that they were going after, but I prefer the Polytour Rev over the other string. So I did like that. I also like things that are more muted. So I think that's why I liked it. But yeah, we noticed that muted feel as well.
And then the other string, I think, Michelle, you were hitting is the Flash by Kirschbaum.
Oh yeah, we've been hitting Kirschbaum Flash like a ton. And that one, I don't know if you're getting
it. Haven't heard of it. No, I haven't heard of it at all. No.
It's also like an insane price point. At least that's what I keep saying.
It's a budget poly.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's going to tennis only or if it's just here in the US. But.
Yeah, haven't heard anything of it.
I'm just going to read you the description. A comfortably firm co-poly that delivers surgical targeting on full swings. It only comes in 17 gauge, or at least that's all we have. And it comes in several colors, which is cool because I like that. But good for players looking for extra power and spin. Above average comfort for poly-based monofilament. Yeah, we've been hitting it a bunch. And everyone's really liking it.
Is it shaped?
It does not. Is it? Troy, do you know?
I didn't really pick up on a shape when I strung it. So I don't think so. I think it might just be like a traditional round. Good deal. And
how much is it?
Right now it's on sale for $6.67.
Oh, stop it.
Yeah.
Stop it.
It retails.
That's a bargain.
Right? It retails under bargain. $9.
Oh, mate. Mate, if you're listening, get on it.
Like, buy now. We'll add a link.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing is like some of these polys, you know, it's a nice investment, but they're expensive. Kirschbaum Flash, you can afford to restring every 2 weeks.
You know, like we talk about these premium polys and like RPM, you know, we're talking about some of the, you know, Yonex strings and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And it's like a lot of times on YouTube, I'll recommend like a budget string, whether it's Cyclone. I really like the Kirschbaum Proline X. And then another one of my favorites, Signum Pro Poly Plasma. They're all like under $10 or like around $8.
Yeah.
And some people are like, well, it can't be that good if it's that cheap. And I'm like, dude, I've tried like everything. And like, I would take those strings over like an RPM, which is like $18, you know, but it's just like the, you know, some of those big names sell because of the marketing or whatever. But if you're being honest, if I didn't work here, like I would be more than happy to use those. And after trying all of them, like some of them outperform those more expensive ones. It's kind of crazy.
Yeah.
I was just about to say that, like, yeah, if I didn't work at Tennis Only and have access to, yeah, I guess all the strings, like there would definitely be some of the more expensive strings that I probably wouldn't play with. I would just go for the middle of the road, middle of the road strings, the Yonex strings, you know. More Solinco, I'd stay away from some high priced ones. All of them, again, just they're all on the same wavelength, some of them. And yeah.
There's a lot of strings out there, and maybe that will be actually, that could be a fun podcast. It's like, if I love XYZ, what's the budget option or what plays? Yeah, that could be fun.
I think it is worth noting though, like when you are playtesting strings, try not to if you're really trying to get into it, try not to fall into the marketing trap. You know, don't fall for everything that you see. Like, just take it as a hit by hit basis and see if it works for you. Don't, you know, see what's advertised as the best string. You know, this is going to do everything for you, because everything is different for everyone. So, you know, just take it as a grain of salt sometimes and find what works best for you.
And you can have unpopular opinions. It's okay not to like what everyone else likes.
Yeah, exactly.
Troy, what else? You got anything else to add? I feel like we should give away some string at the end of this episode. If you have bared with us, let's do like a fun drawing and we'll give some of our favorite shaped polys to, like, what's a great question we could ask for people to like email us in, and you can be in the running to win some of our favorite poly string.
We're going to like quiz them. I'm thinking of like quizzing now. Like,
yeah,
we're like going back to my teacher days, you know, like the first thing I talked about in the podcast was like the science of it, you know, like one of the two main factors when it comes to like the string helping you generate spin. And it had to do with, there's two main factors.
Okay, there you go. That's our question. Email us in with the answer. What two main factors have to do with, I don't even know how to repeat the question, have to do with the spin generation.
Basically talking about the Tennis Warehouse University spin potential ratio and how like Crawford comes up with that spin potential number. And there's two main factors. So you could find it in the Tennis Warehouse University if you want to, but two main factors that go into that spin potential ratio.
Okay. Shoot us an email, podcast@tennis-warehouse.com with the answer, and we'll pick a winner out of that group and we'll send you some of our favorite spin friendly strings. Probably Hyper G will be in there because we all love that string across the whole company.
Hyper G and Cyclone. Done.
So that's wild too, because people even internally are like, oh my gosh, all the playtests you talk about is Hyper G and Cyclone. Yeah. And we didn't even tell you guys in Australia, like, oh, you've come up with that on your own.
Yeah, huge. Oh, that, one of our biggest sellers.
Or for those that are using Hyper G and Cyclone already and already have enough of it or whatnot, and they want to try something else out, just let us know if you get picked as the winner.
Yes.
As long as it's a full set of natural get, we'll hook you up.
If it's exactly. Yeah. If there's a string out there, we'd love to hear that too. If there's a string out there you've not tried and you're interested, let us know. And, you know, the winner can try something new as well, because we know that strings are an investment and it's not always easy to just like shop around different strings, but it is super fun for sure. And I think that would be fun. So email us. You never know. You got to play to win. I think that's all I got.
Yeah, I think we've done well.
I think we have too. I'm gonna say happy hitting. Thanks for listening. Thanks for joining, you guys. Email us at podcast@tennis-warehouse.com with that answer. Also email us if you have any topics that you really want to hear us cover. Jay and Troy are like the go-to gurus for equipment on the pro tour, off the pro tour. They're obviously very knowledgeable about all the things, and hopefully we're going to do some more episodes with them on all kinds of stuff. So if you have anything else specific that you would love to hear us discuss, let us know as well. That's all I got. Thanks for joining. Happy hitting.